Some readers know you have to jump off that cliff of comprehension in order to achieve a greater reward, which is what makes this introduction by Ben Marcus that much more bizarre. The struggles that he admits to in comprehending the work of Diane Williams is the same feeling that I had when I read his own early work. But in some ways, I think Ben is being like this friendly counselor that's walking you through the door of the madhouse before slamming it shut with this evil, maniacal laugh that the author herself indulges in. She was born in 1946, which makes her the same age as my mother. She started appearing in the late 80s in these literary magazines alongside writers who are way more traditional by comparison. She was working in this form that was known as flash fiction or short shorts or micro fictions. She put out a ton of short story collections over time, even coming out with the greatest hits in 98. But I went nuts when this book came out last year, 2018. I thought it'd be interesting to read it all the way through and compare it to the individual collections. I think she was in her 40s when she started publishing, and this first book, which came out in 1990, is my all-time favorite of hers. And she writes from the perspective of someone who's been through a lot of family discord, but at the same time seems to have this insane sex drive that really propels these stories forward. And it's almost like sculpture in a way. Like if you were to cut open a fleshlight and look at the cross section where, you know, different models have different features, like it opens up into these pleasure chambers, but then it bottlenecks into these tight passages that squeeze you a certain way. She might lose you a little bit over here, and because she's too busy like checking out some other dude, but then she'll come over and fluff you a little bit with an obscene sentence or two just to pull you back in. And it gets to be like an instrument that you practice over and over until, you know, you get good enough with it. I mean, you can make some kind of sound. It might not be sounds of pleasure. Then jumping into her second novel, which for some reason it has just skyrocketed in value on the used market more so than any of her other books, which is really bizarre because I would say this book is just the most difficult out of all of her work. And the jump from the first book to the second is so extreme. It was almost like an overcorrection or breaking of style. I mean, there seemed to be some sort of inner turmoil that was going on to cause her to write in this way. Hair getting mistaken for other objects like hats, or orgasms being like the inside of seashells, or, you know, weird innuendos about dogs. But here, she kind of zooms down more at the word level, and it's almost as if, like, as she's composing, you know, maybe she does a typo, but the typo seems interesting, and she wants to leave it in there and kind of riff off that accident in a way. And you kind of wonder if she's doing techniques like S+7. In general, though, I don't really see her having that heavy of a style. It's more of like an anti-style. It's very clean, which is refreshing to see, you know, given that she was part of a certain type of writing group. Christine Schutt, who's often mentioned alongside Williams and whose style is on the opposite end of the spectrum, actually. Speaking of Gordon Lish, it wasn't until this third book to where he was able to publish her as an editor, because to take on her first two books would have just jeopardized his career at Knopf. But when this book came out, and I think in some ways this is the pinnacle of Williams's work, just artistically, I remember just being so excited because this was the first time that she was showcasing some of her longer fiction. It's always such a stark contrast to see her writing next to others, because she seemed to work with this almost alien audacity, which is fitting because in this novella, which is about this couple that goes away on vacation to a cottage, seems to contain an actual alien inside of it, and it becomes like a threesome. But I could be reading it wrong. She used to edit Story Quarterly. This is a cool issue because it had, you can kind of see the writers that she liked to bring in. She's also known as being the editor of Noon. So I wrote this story, and this is also, I'm going to post in the description, in the style of Diane Williams. I mean, hopefully it won't be too, well, it's going to be like super obvious that it is. And we'll just send it off to her. That way we can actually make contact with her. Man, just to live in New York, see what it's like, just boo. Wait, what? Man, I want to go to the museum. How do I get to the museum? Whoa, I'm actually in the museum. What the f... This always reminds me of Matthew Barney for some reason. This is cool. All right. I want to see the outside. Dude's my favorite architect. Oh, cool. Holy shit. Is that her? This one came out in 2001 and this one in 2007. And you can see that she was getting more comfortable stretching her legs and writing longer pieces. This one here contains a work that seems like a take on Updike's Couples. In some ways, the difficulty that she presents, especially on the first read-through and even after multiple read-throughs, itself can become kind of predictable and comfortable in a way, but she changes it up so much with this underlying algorithm that it keeps you kind of guessing and trying to decode how she came about composing it, to the point where maybe it's just all in your mind, because on the surface it's really simple, actually, and there is some connection between the sentences, even though that space kind of is variable. This need for understanding makes you want to float out these different theories just for the fun of it. Plot, characterization, syntax, rhythm, the effects of time, and then maybe takes out bits and pieces from each of these main sections in order to form a chord, which is usually at the sentence level or at the paragraph level, and just riff off it with the next chord, either in a harmonious or disharmonious way. So it becomes sort of a layer, but then she could be working on multiple other layers and putting them on top of each other and merging them down, and then masking and peeling away certain areas so that even though it looks abstract, it still has an impact. Or it could just be this one huge story, the width of which is likely the size of a generation. And she's like this needle that has this short, sticky piece of string on it, and she's weaving it through her imagination, just picking up little bits and pieces here and there. This is a perfect book to read at lunch because you just hit it like three at a time. Also, it worked really good while sitting on the toilet. In this one, she really hits her stride in a certain way. It's like she's got this witty cadence going on, although there's not much logic behind the wit. As in most cases with Williams, though, you have to be alert and present. And if you're like even the slightest bit tired, you know, something interesting might happen though. You could take some of these words, will start to spin off on their own and create this alternate story in your subconscious that might be even more interesting than what's there in front of you. But it turns out to be like a dream though, because you can't really recall what it is. And this is the last one that she put out. It's kind of interesting. It's kind of interesting what's going on with the cover here. Given how over time her work is, I wouldn't really say relevant, because it's still kind of ahead of its time, and even the work from the past. And for her to be able to sustain it for so long, there's this almost timeless quality about it where other writers have kind of come and gone, and there's sometimes that inevitable decline that happens. Her writing has just managed to stay fresh, and every time you go back to it, it's just constant surprises and shocks. Kind of forget how to walk straight or look people in the eye trying to unpack this shit. And it really ended up with you getting your own shit packed.
Yes, it's very difficult.
You know, you can take the lines and jumble them up, and that's nicely fractured, but nobody's going to read it, right?